Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business today is whether we take item 3 in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. We now turn to our next item of business, which is an evidence session on our inquiry into low income and debt problems. So far, we've been running sessions with our Experts by Experience panel, who are sharing their lived experience of debt with the committee. We have also held formal evidence sessions on the 28th of April and the 12th of May. And today we are hearing from a large panel of witnesses to discuss a range of different types of arrears. And I'll begin by welcoming our panel this morning. Online, we are joined by Paul Ferguson, member and association executive of the Institute of Revenues, Rating and Valuation. Paul is also the Revenues and Benefits Manager at Falkirk Council. We also have Gordon McRae, who's the Assistant Director of Communications and Advocacy at Shelter Scotland, and Kirsty McKechnie, who's the Early Warning Systems Project Manager at the Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland. And in the room with us today, we have Betty Stone, who's the chair of the Edinburgh Tenants Federation. We have Karen Carrick, who's the Evaluations Manager of the Improvement Service. And we have Martin Canavan, who is the head of policy and participation at Aberlour. Good morning, everyone. A few housekeeping points just to kick us off. We do have a large panel this morning, and given your ears of expertise, I'll say that we have a lot of cross-cutting nature on today. Some of the issues discussed is maybe not an area that you maybe need to contribute to, and we are here for 2 hours. We will have a wee break in the middle, I think, because we're going to need it. And thank you very much for making that time this morning. Don't feel compelled to have to speak to every single point that we're going to put in front of you. And always you can follow up in writing at the end of if you think there's something that you need to make sure that we know. Please indicate if you're in the room by raising your hand that you want to come in. If you are on blue jeans, type a wee R in the chat box and I'll be keeping an eye on that to bring you in as well. And just give our broadcasting colleagues a wee second to turn your microphones on before you start speaking. And I won't forget that comfort break at 10 o'clock because I think by then we'll all need it. So I'm going to turn to questions from members because we do have a lot of them. And I'm going to ask them in turn. My first question is going to be coming from Paul McClellan, and who's in the room, and then to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Yeah, morning, convener, morning, panel. I think one of the things we've probably seen in the last few weeks in evidence is how the private sector and how the public sector deal with debt. So the question really from myself is, do you think the public sector are behind the private sector in dealing with that at the moment? And I'm just trying to think who that will go to first. Probably yourself first, Martin, if you want to come in on that one, and I'll open it up to see whoever wants to come in.
Certainly. And thanks very much to the committee for inviting us along here to give evidence this morning. There's probably others on the panel that can give some real kind of insight into the kind of technical nature of the public sector versus private sector. But I think from what we are seeing at Aberlour, we are seeing a real significant increase in families who are experiencing levels of public debt, specifically to local authorities, to housing associations, to DWP and others. And we're seeing quite a difficult and challenging circumstances as some of those debts are pursued and recovered by public bodies. I think some of the research that we've been doing, that's been led by Professor Traynor at Heriot Watt University, that I think we've shared with you in our evidence, has highlighted there is a real disparity between the way in which public debts or debts by public bodies are pursued versus private sector. The private sector, I think, is regulated by the Financial Conduct Authority and there are regulations around how those debts can be pursued. I think they don't apply to the public sector, and what we're seeing is a real punitive approach at times, a real escalation in terms of the speed at which debts can be recovered. And that's really difficult and challenging for many families that we're working with, that Aberlour are supporting, who are in deep, deep financial difficulty. And what we're seeing is we're actually seeing the vast majority of the debt that families that we support have is to public bodies. And so the circumstances around that debt recovery and the inconsistency often around that debt recovery, I'll maybe speak a little bit more in detail about the inconsistency in relation to things like school meal debt, which we've covered in our evidence.
Yep.
But there's a real inconsistency around how that is approached across the country, but largely it seems to be difficult, challenging, punitive at times, and really fundamentally quite challenging for families' wider wellbeing. I'm sure there's others on the panel that can speak in more detail about the public versus private sector, however.
No, Martin, thanks for that, because I think obviously reading the evidence you had, and obviously I think it says, and I think debt levels in the UK is like £13.5 billion.
Yeah.
You know, obviously Scotland takes its share, you're probably talking about £1.5 to £2 billion. Just extending that, if that's okay, it'll probably come to Kirsty on the same question, if that's okay.
Yes, of course, thank you, and thank you very much for having me along today. I think the thing that we're finding that's quite surprising in relation to the public debt is that some of it could be avoided with better administration. Through things like universal credit, there's no onus on universal credit really to get decisions right in the first place, because all overpayments are recoverable. And I think in relation to council tax debt, some of the council tax arrears could be avoided if we had a more transparent council tax reduction system, if there were more decision letters issued, if it was easier for claimants to access council tax reduction. So I think, like the other organisations that have spoken before, and I would agree with Martin about the free school meal debt, the school meal debt as well. More and more clients are coming with debts that are to the public service rather for essentials rather than for sort of what would be considered to be consumer credit.
Okay. Kirsty, from your own point of view, obviously the Child Poverty Action Group, are you seeing if it's a split in families? You know, is there that real distinctive split? Obviously, families with children, families without. Is there? And I'm trying to remember who gave us evidence before. The first 2 or 3 years are incredibly important in a child's life. Are you seeing that impact and going forward beyond that? And so, I suppose, you know, is a real impact that we need to look at in terms of younger children or children, maybe older families, older kids, and so on. So, is there a split, a distinctive split, in what you're seeing with the work that you're doing?
I think that, I mean, all families are being affected at the moment, but I think there's evidence from Trussell Trust showing that because of the more families that are being affected by the two-child limit in the early years of a child's life, there's an increasing number of families with younger children using food banks, and we think that that might be a direct correlation as a result of the two-child limit. And in terms of the public sector debt, that can affect anybody. One of the things that we are seeing at the moment is a very aggressive collection of historic council tax credit debt and social fund debt. The people who had maybe claimed these benefits in the past, these debts are now being sought through universal credit. And often they're so old that there's very little way of anybody being able to find any evidence about whether, in fact, there's a debt there in the first place. And there's certainly very few ways for people to challenge those debts after such a long period of time. So we can find that, absolutely, families with younger children are very much affected by the kind of lower income, but families with older children may well find they're having their benefits deducted because of historic debt as well.
Okay. So if anybody else wants to come in.
Much for that, Kirsty. I think that I've seen that myself, where the tax credits debts, and sometimes they're in their thousands and they're from years ago, and that's just some, you know, a family can never get out the bet when that actually arrives, and they can't find the information going back to actually try and defend their position or change the outcome. I'll move to questions from Jeremy Balfour. Jeremy, thanks.
Good morning, and thank you all very much for coming this morning. I wonder if I can just follow, just for questioning from Paul, up a wee bit further, and I'm not sure if anyone wants to just jump into this one. Is my understanding, I'd be interested to know if this is your understanding, is that there is a legal duty on local authorities to pursue that debt under the powers that they've been granted, and that if they don't do that, then they would then possibly lose funding back. Am I right in that? Can anyone give us an answer towards that?
I think if we could perhaps go to Paul Ferguson for that, and maybe Karen from the Improvement Service as well. Paul?
Yeah, yes, thank you very much. Yeah, I think I'm not aware of any legal obligation that requires to do so, but obviously a moral obligation communities to do so, because obviously any debts that we pursue, Falkirk Council have to fund the services that we provide. So I think that's that moral duty. I'm not aware of a legal duty, but obviously I don't think that's crucial here. It's about what we need to, the right thing is the right thing to do, and that is to recover debts from those that can pay it and to support those that cannot pay it to achieve positive outcomes. The one thing I would qualify is that when we set council tax, for example, we have to set a bad debt provision or expected collection rate. If there's factors that limit that, then that obviously means a larger increase in council tax for other households. So if we cannot collect as much as we historically did, we would have to increase council tax further to fill that gap.
Can I just follow up on that then? So what would be a policy? So if somebody comes in with an issue in regard to the council tax or rent arrears, how would that look like in a practical level by local authorities?
If I got some context here, as well as having revenue responsibilities, I also have the advice service at Falkirk Council. So I have two roles here. I've worked closely with Karen Carrick, who's on the panel as well, Human Service and other advice agencies on the collaborative council tax collection, which is a very good piece of work we did back in late 2019 that I think the panel's made aware of before, and we're hoping to relaunch that this month or early next month. But what it looks like, if somebody comes to us, then our duty is to actually maximise their benefits, make sure all the help they're getting, which is council tax relief, reduction, etc., and any other welfare benefits, and then look at what opportunities there are to pay the ongoing charge and what's left to pay the historical debts. So there's no one size fits all, but we need to consider individuals here. There's not a blanket. So we have advice support hubs, so it's an individual case. We assess their individual circumstances, maximise their income, maximise the relief to minimise the charge, and then ensure they can pay the ongoing charges in a way that suits their income, and then deal with the historical debts. But what we want to do is make sure we get them as early as possible to avoid that debt being too material.
I think some of the evidence we've taken in previous panels is that once you're in that system though and you can't pay, there seems to be an almost, you're into a machine, but then you end up with legal action being taken against you. And I suppose just from a local authority perspective, is there any way of that being adapted and changed so that, you know, if you can't, you don't suddenly end up in the show of court? Or is that just something that local authorities again do simply because of the procedures that are there in place?
There's an issue of scale here to council tax. Council tax is an annual charge, which includes obviously around about 27% of that is water charges and more for those low income. And because annual charge, we want to make sure that we collect the current year in full if possible to avoid it carrying forward into next year. So yes, we do issue reminders quite sharply. We do follow up on those with final notices fairly sharply, and we do go to summary warrant, which incurs 10% costs. Any engagement at all at any point in those early stages will stop that action and allow a remedy. The problem is that it's what's the trigger for that household. When does that trigger come and ask for help? And our duty is to try and make sure they come and ask for help earlier. And that's our duty to continue to improve to make sure we don't. Those who can't pay and are struggling to try and incentivise them coming and ask for help, because we want to create that trust with ourselves and our partners. And we don't yet have that as the issue. It's fairly clear from evidence before that people are not engaging with us early because they don't believe there'll be a positive outcome. And that's the problem we have to turn around.
And then one final question, just on a slightly different theme. Do we know, in regard to the debt that is still outstanding, how much of it would, say, be historical, so over 10 years old, and how much of it would be, say, within the last 5 years? Do we have is it possible to get that type of breakdown?
Yes, it's got to produce figures, and that's what's called the CTRR return. So for council tax, if I focus on council tax, then there's a CTRR return that's submitted that includes the age of each debt, so what year the debt relates to for each local authority. So yes, that information is available. I can try and find a link to it, but that's certainly there in the public sector.
Thank you, Kavina.
Thank you very much for that. I think Karen wants to come in on that. Thanks.
Yeah, it's really just to pick up on the point that Paul made about the Collaborative Council Tax Guide. That was a piece of work that Step Change Scotland funded us to do. And the idea was that we could try and resolve some of these issues at a local level before they actually got to the enforcement process. But a range of partners got together and we identified principles that we thought could be rolled out in each local area that would help councils to work with third sector partners and others to actually take a more sympathetic approach, if you like, to recovering council tax arrears. So as Paul said, a lot of this is actually set in legislation. So there was, we identified that, there was a limited scope for flexibility. But unfortunately, the pandemic intervened. We couldn't launch the guide, but we are planning to launch it later on this month. The intention is to follow that up in 6 months' time, just to see how effectively it's been used in each area. But if I could say something about sort of public versus private in terms of how things operate. Most councils have fairness and equality duties as well. They also have anti-poverty committees. And there is that imperative in local authorities to try and protect those most vulnerable and make sure that they access the services that they need. So key to making sure that you don't go down the enforcement process, as Paul has said, is to make sure that people get access to advice at an early stage. And I think that's kind of critical in the process. And that's what we're suggesting in wider research that we've done, but also in the guide that we've produced, that's the key point. If you can get people into that, get them the advice, get their incomes maximised, then that will help mitigate against these kind of recovery processes.
Can I just, thank you very much. I suppose the issue that we've been hearing for the last few weeks is that isn't working. So we've got a crisis at the moment with people with fewer bills, fewer food, all these issues. And the evidence that we've been hearing is that local authorities seem to be pursuing this quite vigorously. And so, you know, it may be a kind of thing that is on paper, but it doesn't seem to be happening in practice. And so I suppose the question for me, Karen, is over the next 6 or 9 months, so 6 months is quite a long time away in regard to a lot of people who are struggling with debt at the moment, for the next 6 or 7 months, what should local authorities be doing? What advice should Scottish Government, should COSLA, should the Parliament be given to local authorities at this particular moment in the situation that is here at the moment?
I think funding advice services is always a challenge, and I've no doubt other people have said that to you. I wouldn't necessarily accept that it's not working everywhere. I think I can't speak for all local authorities, but there are many examples where there is effective practice in place. We're an improvement organisation, so what we do is gather evidence and use it to suggest improvement actions that local authorities and their partners might take. For the past 7 years, we've collected data on how local authority investment in advice services, welfare advice and money advice. So we have that data set that we can look at trends and establish what's happening. Because of the pandemic, there has been a drop, as you know, in requests for advice. But interestingly, what we also identified in that period, and this was before we had the energy crisis, was that demand for energy advice, the energy debt being the primary reason for seeking advice, had risen. So that's a flag for the future, I think, that we do need to be aware of, that was happening during the pandemic. That's going to take off in the future. What I think local authorities do when they do best is when they work in partnership, and a lot of that has happened because of COVID. I'm not saying this is across the board, but there are examples of this. We're doing some work currently for Scottish Government on accessible advice. So that's about taking advice into areas where people are most likely to use it, for instance, in schools, GP practices. And there's lots of examples of that approach that's been taken. At the moment, we're rolling out a programme where there are 150 GP practices who will have an advice worker ultimately embedded in that practice, where there can be a straight, non-stigmatising referral from a GP or a health visitor to actually see somebody in the surgery. And we know that that works from research we've done and also from research from the Glasgow Centre for Population and Health. We're also doing some research on what happens in schools. And there's great examples in Glasgow, for instance, of how advice is being provided in secondary schools throughout Glasgow. There's examples in South Lanarkshire where the council are working with the CEB to make sure that people get their £100 payment towards their council tax. And in some ways, that's kind of an incentive to access advice services. We also know that digital access to advice is here to stay. We saw from the research we did that initially, from a period where perhaps about 4% of advice services were delivered, funded by local authorities, were delivered digitally, that rose to close on 70%. So there was a marked increase there. I suppose what I'm saying is that the key to this is access to advice services, and they're best served when they're delivered using a partnership approach. And local authorities, I think, do want to offer that service to people because they do recognise the role that they have in relation to promoting equality and fairness.
I apologise, my final question, then I will pass on, is, would that, again, my understanding from evidence you've taken from previous weeks is that the advice is not a statutory duty for local authorities. So I know a lot of them do fund it, but it's not something they have to do. Do you think it would make any difference if that became a statutory duty that they had to offer advice across all 32 local authorities to make it so that then at least those who are working in that area, you know, would know that they have funding coming for future years as well?
I think it's kind of tangentially a statutory duty. The Bankruptcy Act says you've got to make sure that people seek advice, but it's not something that's laid down in law. My concern would be that if it's a statutory duty, it'll be added to all the other ones, and that will take away the ability in some senses to meet local needs and circumstances. It might be better to think about maybe some sort of minimum standards in terms of the advice services that were offered, and that would allow there to be that kind of local flexibility engagement that could be adapted for each area.
Thank you, Camino.
Okay, before I move to my colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy with her questions, I've got Martin and Betty that both would like to come in. If I can ask you to keep your comments brief at this point, if that's okay. Martin first.
Certainly, thanks, Camino, and I'll try and be as brief as possible. It was really just to come back to that point of the public versus private debt, and I would agree with a lot of what Karen said there. I think there's a real need to look at how we can have standards, guidelines, and ensure kind of consistency and a rights-based approach to how we respond to people in a kind of local understanding, kind of local circumstances for people. In terms of the where we are in relation to council tax arrears and council tax debt specifically, I think it's probably important to highlight that we are in Scotland. We're behind other parts of the UK in this, you know, around the statute of limitations, for example, in terms of council tax arrears. You know, that historic debt that we've already touched on this morning, you know, we could go a long way to reducing the impact and the financial anxiety and the insecurity people are experiencing by reducing that statute of limitations to 5 years, so it's more consistent with the rest of the country, the rest of the UK. And there's already steps towards legislating in England, I think, around government debt management. And I think that's certainly something that we should consider here in Scotland as well. I think in our evidence we've called for the Scottish Government to look at introducing a public debt management bill that will seek to ensure that there's a consistent approach nationally and that we can respond appropriately to those who find themselves in real kind of problem debt to public bodies. And also just in terms of some of the work we're continuing to do, building on the work that Professor Traynor has already done. She's currently looking at the council tax specifically and the way in which and the time and the effort that it requires local authorities to chase and pursue the debt that people will be accumulating, particularly in relation to council tax, and whether or not there's an argument there about whether it's the most efficient use of public resource and public funding. And is there a different or a better way that we can think about how we use resources, maybe push towards recovery and actually thinking about how we just support and respond more appropriately to people who might find themselves in cycles of problem debt.
And over to yourself, Betty, and then we've got Kirsty who wants to briefly come in as well.
Thank you for having me this morning. I have a big issue with the council, the way that they approach people for these debts. They send letters out to people. The amount of literacy in Edinburgh alone is 33.3%. A lot of these people don't even know how to read these letters, and that worries me. And I'm pushing for to get the housing officers back on the ground where they should be, out meeting the people and addressing these issues with the people. Because when we send them to the services that are out there, there's a waiting list there about 3 months before they're seen. And that is horrendous. And as you talk about funding them, yes, they should be funded to help these people, definitely.
Thank you very much for that, Betty. And Kirsty, please.
Thank you. Just coming back to the question that Mr. Balfour made about what could Scottish Government do, what could local authorities do. At the moment, there's no onus on local authorities to provide decision letters in relation to council tax reduction decisions. And this means that it's not very transparent if somebody is receiving council tax reduction, if there's a change that decreases, that could happen mid-year and somebody wouldn't be aware of the change in their requirements to pay their council tax. And because of that, we think it would be an instruction to local authorities to issue decisions letters would be hugely helpful to the claimants, to the people who are trying to advise claimants. It might help avoid council tax arrears and also make sure that people are responding to any issues with council tax reduction in a timely manner. At the moment, you can only have council tax reduction backdated for up to 6 months, and you have 2 months to request a review of a decision. But if the decision isn't notified in the first place, that 2 months can quite often disappear without you knowing anything about it. And in one of the cases we submitted in our evidence, in fact, it was somebody who would have been entitled to help with their council tax arrears, but for the passage of time, which had stopped them being able to claim the council tax reduction that they would have been entitled to for that period. And because of that, somebody was left with council tax arrears that they could have, in fact, have had financial support to pay for. And I think that's something that could change and would improve council tax arrears, and particularly would improve incomes for people on low incomes.
Thank you very much, Kirsty, for setting that out quite clearly for us. Thank you. I'll move to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for all the evidence you've given so far this morning, but also the evidence you've submitted in advance today. And I'd also, again, like to put on record my thanks to organisations specifically who've been supporting people and their membership throughout a really, really, really tough couple of years. So thank you for all that you've done. I actually want to explore a little bit of the kind of council tax and the public debt mechanisms that we've spoke about, and then also understand a bit about the experience that families are living in just now. So I'll start on the same theme that we've just been on. I too, Betty, share your concerns about the way that local authorities are pursuing debt. And this morning, I feel, if I'm honest, that what I've heard from members, particularly from people, particularly this morning, is that there seems to be quite a bit of onus on individuals. So, like the statutory duty, as you say, Karen, is about ensuring people access advice rather than ensuring the advice is provided or funded. So that really puts the burden of any kind of responsibility on someone who's in debt, and someone who's in debt is struggling. By definition, obviously. So I wonder if there's anything that perhaps Karen or Paul could suggest that could help shift the burden of responsibility to local authorities to improve the system rather than to individuals to seek support earlier. I'm not suggesting we want people to seek support at the last minute either, but I feel like the burden of responsibility needs to change. Karen and Paul, if that's okay.
I think it's about providing advice in a way that people can access it. I think that is the key to it. And people aren't going to access it through letters, a letter going to them. What they need is to know in a way that meets their needs how they can get advice, and to get that advice from someone they trust or they can believe in. And that could be somebody in the third sector or the public sector. It doesn't really matter who's providing it as long as they can engage with that person. So I think the onus should be on improving access to advice services. And I think there's a connection there. And councils are starting to do it between revenues and benefit sections and advice. And as Paul said, he manages both. So he has a good overview of what's actually happening in Falkirk. But I think that probably is the key to it.
Thank you.
To come in on this, Paul, thanks.
Yes, thank you. I think that the issues we covered with the pre-action requirements that apply within the rental sector and the social rental sector, where we have to provide those links to that advice in advance of taking any action. So we tell people how they can help, where they get help and how to do that. I think we try to mirror that for council tax, and I think we should all do a bit more of that. I think that Karen's point is valid. People need to trust somebody, and I think that's my big concern is now that people don't yet trust us. And I can see why, having heard the evidence today, that people have had bad experiences with councils. But certainly the ones that do engage with my team, I am confident that they will get a good outcome. But the problem is that I need to motivate them to do that. I think so do others. I don't know quite how we achieve that across the whole of Scotland, but I do think it's about making sure that we can outline to people how they can help, give them a choice of places. They can go to CB, they can go to the council, they can go to another third sector, to make sure they're not compelled to go to something they don't trust. I think that's what we're certainly trying to do, and hopefully have some good outcomes. And again, we then need to build a relationship with those partners to make sure that when they do go to that individual, they get a good outcome through that third party as well. So I've not got any quick fixes, but I do think there are opportunities here for us to improve that.
Thank you. Paul, could I just ask a further question on that? And then I've only got one last question in this theme. Is there any way that the way in which local authorities collect revenue, so to stop people needing advice services in the first place, is there anything we can do during the revenue collection process that would prevent people from needing them, basically, be a bit more preventative? So, like, for example, telling people that they've got a council tax reduction. Can you think of any examples that we could use there to prevent it?
Yeah, there's quite a number of examples. Most councils have a debt collection policy or a fair collection policy, and that sort of frames how we do things. It's all about minimising the charge, make sure people are aware, and the CAB are very good about that. It's their tool to allow people to access that, as is Martin Lewis, to make sure people minimise the charges. So what we do is, at Falkirk, on top of those things about making sure people are aware of the opportunities of reducing it, we offer 142 different ways to pay. People can pay weekly, fortnightly, monthly, four-weekly, over 12 months, 10 months, whether they pay with that debit or not. What we need to do is make sure people know what options are out there. And I think that what we found at Falkirk is around 80% of our customers pay on an agreed plan out with the normal installments, because they pay over a 12-month period of pay with that debit. And that means that by doing that, that allows us to focus on 20%, and that's what we want to do, spend that time on that 20% that needs our help. Most of our debt, and I think Betty mentioned this, if I look at my council's debt, most of it is owed by my social rented tenants. So my tenants for rent owe me most of my council's debt. And I think we do need to understand those tenants better, what their needs are, whether it be literacy or beyond that. And we have housing officers who go out and try and establish those needs and address those. So we need to be proactive, especially those in the social rented sector, for me, to make sure that we can identify what extra support they need beyond just standard letters, so we can tailor our approach to them to meet those needs. And I think that's easy to do if we have both sides, but it's hard to do if you work independently. So we need to combine the debts. As I think it's been said before, councils have a stream of debts to collect. The more you bring them together, the more effective you are actually identifying the needs of those individuals you're dealing with, and the more you can make that journey easier for those debtors, because they don't just owe me rent, they owe me house and debt overpayments, they owe me sundry debts, they owe me council tax. The more we can sort of join up and give one solution to that, the better chance is to provide a remedy to that.
Thank you. Much appreciated. Martin, I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about the experiences of the people who've been accessing your fund recently. And in particular, I was really struck by the way that you described that what you're seeing is not just relative but absolute poverty. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, certainly. So just for a little bit of context, Aberlour operate a hardship fund, our urgent assistance fund, which we've operated for a number of years, but unsurprisingly, you'll know that over the last couple of years, since the start of the pandemic, the demand on that fund has increased by some degree. So the demand and the increase in that fund and the number of families and applications and awards that we're able to provide has really allowed us to be able to identify some real clear patterns in terms of the circumstances of families, some really concerning issues that have emerged as a result. And one of the things that we've become acutely aware of is the issue of debt, public debt particularly. I think somewhere in the region of about 1 in 7 families who apply to our fund are applying specifically to access funding, to access help and support to pay off debt. And almost almost exclusively. 100% in some cases for families, the vast majority of the debt that families have is to public bodies. I think what's probably really important also just to say, kind of in terms of framing, is we're hearing a lot just now about cost of living crisis. It's everywhere you look, newspapers, television, and I don't think we can get away from that. But actually, the cost of living crisis is a crisis for many people and very serious. But it's not new for a lot of people. For a lot of people on the lowest incomes, they've been experiencing a cost of living crisis for many, many years, long before the pandemic and the current financial environment. And what we're seeing through the Urgent Assistance Fund is the symptom of that, the impact of that. We are seeing people who have been accumulating debt are in real significant problem situations because their incomes have simply not been enough to cover the costs of heating their homes, feeding their children, providing the very basics. And so the families that we are seeing, I mean, our concern isn't just around the immediate financial needs of the family, it's about the long-term consequences and the impact of what that means for families. Families who are trapped in ongoing long-term cycles of debt, and regardless of who are on the lowest incomes, and even the increases that there have been, whether it's been the universal credit uplift for the period that it was available or the increase in the Scottish Child Payment, actually, while on the face of it, that might be increasing the incomes of some families. For families who are in real significant debt to public bodies, all it is doing is ensuring there's more money coming from one part of the public sector and going back out the other way to service the debts that families have to public bodies. And so families aren't, in many cases, aren't actually seeing the impact of the full benefit of those increases in social security that they might be on paper receiving. So, but even beyond that and the financial circumstances, what we know about the long-term implications and the long-term impact of poverty on families, on children and young people's mental health, on parents' mental health, on wider family well-being, the impact it can have children's education, the long-term and lifelong consequences for families and for children as they grow up and grow older as a result of living in poverty are manifold. We know that. And for us, it's crucial that we do everything that we can do just now. There are steps that we know there's calls in the UK government to do lots just now to address the cost of living crisis for people. It's a cost of living catastrophe, as I think I said already, for so many families that Aberlour work with. But there's other things that Scottish Government and others could be doing. And again, I know we'll speak about the school meal debt specifically at some point this morning. But for us, the real concern is, as Pam has already mentioned, is the levels of poverty that we're seeing, the levels of deprivation that we're seeing, that we would describe as being closer to absolute poverty than relative poverty. Families who are sleeping on mattresses on floors, who are sharing covers at night to keep themselves warm, families who cannot provide just the simple, most simple and basic items for them and their family. That's what our Urgent Assistance Fund is there to provide. But the sheer demand and rise on the use of that fund over the last couple of years has been really alarming and really concerning. And we're really worried about what the long-term implications are for the well-being of children and families who grew up in poverty right now in Scotland.
Thank you very much, Martin, for that powerful evidence there. It's certainly something I recognise as having worked in the support industry in terms of homelessness for a long time. This is an issue that has always been, and it's an issue that is not new at all. So thank you for that. I'm going to now move on to theme two, which is round about rent arrears. And to start us off with that, I've got my colleague Natalie Dawn, who is remote. She will come in with the first questions, and then my colleague Emma Roddick, who's also remote. So over to Natalie, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thank you for your contributions so far. So yeah, looking at the theme of rent arrears, the importance of early intervention has been highlighted throughout this inquiry, and obviously we've discussed that already this morning. So when looking at rent arrears, in terms of the pre-action requirements that are in place to protect both social and private tenants from eviction, how effective do the panel feel in ensuring that eviction action is avoided wherever possible? How effective do the panel feel they have been? Sorry, if I could put that to Gordon first, please.
Good morning, thank you. Are they effective? Yes. Are they the whole answer? No. And I think the pandemic powers to make the action requirements and so forth have really been it's kind of a framework for people to engage, and it's ensured that there's a paper trail, and also it takes us closer to a situation where private rented sector and the social rented sector are more aligned. You know, at a time when, you know, through, you know, historic decisions, we've decided more low income households can only choose housing in the private rented sector. It's necessary that we have protections that match the expectation that government decision makers have of a sector that's not really set up for that type of social benefit to be able to protect them. So we think it's a good thing, but they do need to be improved. They do need to be enforced. And in particular, we would say that there's a real lack of data when it comes to what's called the Section 11 notices. That's when a private landlord or a creditor is supposed to inform the local authority that they're about to take possession of a property and make someone homeless. We don't know, quite simply. We could hazard a guess, but we don't know. We don't have sight of enough data to say whether that's working well enough. But the data we do have is that we know that the Shelter Scotland Law Service continues to be quite successful at preventing eviction because of rent arrears when we're able to offer someone representation in court. And that shows us that local authorities and private landlords both don't always do everything that they say. And they will say, and undoubtedly it's a last resort, but either because the protocols aren't followed to the letter of the law, or because there's evidence that the tenant would have engaged or was trying to engage, was trying to make a payment plan, come up with a mitigating way of dealing with it, and the court finds in their favour. So the pre-action requirements are a good innovation. We're pleased that they've come in. We think the discretionary elements of that should be made permanent, so that the pre-action requirements and the rules around these things, they shouldn't be triggers. We should have judgment and some understanding of individual circumstances. Look at cases case by case, rather than saying you've hit the threshold, you're out in the street. We know that when eviction takes place, it can cost a conservative estimate for a single person being in temporary accommodation, not requiring much support, is about £24,000. It's not a cost-effective thing for the public sector. And so we think, let's keep PARs, pre-action requirements, in place. Let's look at how to make them more effective. But let's not fall into the trap of thinking they alone are a silver bullet to the problem.
No, thank you. Yeah, I noted that in the evidence that you put in, the cost of an eviction is averaging at £24,000 for a family, and total cost of social sector evictions, I believe, in 2019 to 2020 was £27.8 million. Now, given both the financial cost to the local authority and just like the emotional stress that an eviction can have on a person or a family, I mean, it does. We know it doesn't seem like the best way to deal with rent arrears. And especially when you think of it as somebody's going to go back into a homeless accommodation, and then they're going to have to get rehoused, and it's sort of a horrible cycle. So what other options do you think that councils would have in dealing with it? And do you feel that there are any further improvements that could be made? I know you've kind of touched on that there, could be made to the processes and procedures around rent arrears collection in general. I'll stick with you, Gordon, just now, and then I'll maybe bring in Betty and Karen. Thanks.
It's been mentioned today already around the issue of access to advice and support, but I would also say representation. Representation is a crucial element of that as well. I would point out that making information available is not the same as making a referral. There's still a leaky pipe, if you will, of people being told where they can go. But the resilience of someone who is experiencing multiple debts, not just rent arrears, to be able to then navigate through to the right person, share all their information again. The advisor then has to get in touch with the creditor and get their side of the story. Once they've evidenced that they've got the authority to act on that person's behalf, it is a it is good where it works, and it does make a massive difference, but it's not easy. It's time consuming. It's not well resourced. We're still very reliant on charitable donations, not just at Shelter Scotland, but in other organisations, to mitigate these failures by landlords and both the social and the private sector. So it is difficult. I think the ideas around, you know, where engagement takes place early, where you can show that the offer of support, advice, representation is coming from someone that can be trusted, and Paul's mentioned this a couple of times. It does make a big difference. We've been running a pilot in Dundee for some time that has been incredibly effective at just getting people talking. The first step in most of this is, you know, people who are getting letters through the door that they don't want to open because they know what's inside it. They're not, you know, they need that human contact. And we need the courts and the tribunals to take a kind of holistic view, to understand that this isn't just about a narrow view of debt recovery, of arrears recovery. It's about what happens to that household, how does that impact on them, but also the people around them, because it has an impact on our schools, it has an impact on health. We know the social impact of eviction, especially for children, is lifelong. And if it can be avoided, because and usually because of family breakdown, because of losing a job, because of coming ill, these are everyday human experiences. They're not exceptions. It is being exacerbated by the pandemic. It's exacerbated by things like advice services not being open during the pandemic, face-to-face advice not being as available. But the more we focus on getting people to an advisor, to a service, rather than just a kind of a web link or a telephone number, then I think the more difference we'll see longer term.
And can we hear from Betty on that, please, and Karen, if she wants to add anything?
The difficulty we have, I think the worst thing they ever done was universal credit, of course, handing the money to the people in their hand. I've found that rent arrears have went through the roof since universal credit come out. The difference is when they used to take their rent off of their payment, and that way they were insuring it. But what we do, we've not been able to, with the pandemic being there, but we've started setting things up again. We're going to do roadshows out in the areas, and what we take with us is a housing officer and also an officer that deals with repairs. But we insist that the housing officer and the other council worker is dressed down, no labels on them to say who they are, and it's surprising how the public come out and actually talk to them, and not realising who they are, but once they realise that they can get the help, that has made that makes a huge difference to them, and it's worked in the past. So we're setting them up again to go over Edinburgh in the areas where there is difficulties, where we know there's difficulties with people with their rent. But the private sector, the rents are horrendous in the private sector. And what I think the council is lacking in is, are they checking that all these landlords are actually registered? Because if they're not registered, they can get a huge fine for not being registered. And I think they're lacking in that. They used to check up, but I've never heard lately. There used to be a committee that sat in it. I was on it. That's all gone. I think they need to check back there and put a cap on the private sector, on their rents.
Thanks very much for that, Betty. And I think it's important to remind us about that change to universal credit and giving people their, you know, the housing payments in their hand. And if we have the Scottish Choices where they can choose to pay it direct to landlord, but it's about the knowledge of that process. So it's again back to people being armed with all the information to make the right decisions that work for them, absolutely. Karen, I don't know if you want to come in, and then I've got Paul
very briefly.
Who's online. Yep.
It's just to sort of echo what Betty said, that having the voice of people with experience is really critical in the process, and all too often advice services reviews have been conducted without that. think that's an integral part of this. I think if there is a process in place, then rather than inventing a new one, it would be better to make that one work more effectively and to highlight why it's not in those areas. And finally, just to give another example in Dundee, that's been led by Brooksbank, where they're working with other advice agencies and the council. Each week they meet to look to see who has capacity to take referrals. And by doing that, what they're trying to do is make sure that people get access to advice quicker. And that will ensure that, you know, they follow their advice journey through.
Thanks very much for that. And Paul, I think you want to come in as well.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks. Just two very quick points. One, to echo what Gordon said about just giving people the point of contact is good enough. We need to go and see them, and definitely need some, make a sort of warm handover to whoever's going to support them through this. But on Betty's point, with Universal Credit, just for some context, I had an eviction panel yesterday where Universal Credit and the failures of how that system would work for that person were undoubtedly a factor of why they arrived at that stage. We didn't decide to go with the eviction just now. We will go and re-engage with that person and offer support to them. But I think also the phone call yesterday from my leave and care team, where they had a leave and care person who was taking responsibility, who was under Universal Credit, had asked that the first payment of them be paid direct to the landlord. That wasn't done. They thought the extra money in the bank account was just because they were now living in their own house rather than because it was their housing costs, and they spent it, and they now have rent arrears in the first 2 months of their tenancy, despite them attempting to do the right things. So Universal Credit is not as effective as the housing benefit was at protecting the most vulnerable. And I think that that's something that we need to work hard to resolve for those people by education and by support.
Thanks very much for that, Paul. And Martin, you want to come in briefly as well?
Just briefly at the end, and I think I just wanted to say a little bit about some of the work that we've got underway in Tayside, which speaks to how we can perhaps think differently and better in a more coordinated and holistic way about how we support families who are who have rent arrears as well as often a combination of other types of debt. We've been running a pilot for a number of months now that's been funded by the Robertson Trust across Tayside, across three local authorities, to provide financial assistance for vulnerable families. And all of those families have rent arrears amongst other things, other debts that are causing them real deep anxiety. And what we have done is, alongside the provision of welfare rights officers, we are alongside, as part of a kind of family support approach, we're also providing help and support for families directly to help families, children, the whole family, support them with the other issues that the financial concerns, financial issues, financial anxiety kind of exacerbate and make even more challenging and even worse. And I think we're already beginning to see some really positive outcomes as a result. You know, in some cases, some of those families that are referred to us, of which there's been about 40, I think, the turnaround from accessing the service to being effectively on an even keel has been about 6 weeks in some cases. When they have the opportunity to get that consistent advice, consistent support, direct point of contact, as well as the additional holistic family support that goes alongside it to help address the other issues that families are experiencing, we're beginning to see some real, real positive impacts. And just to say something about one of the parents that we've supported through that, she commented that the amount of stress that's been relieved now is unreal, and now I feel I'm able to maintain and budget my current income to support my girls. In the future, as my debt has been paid off, I'm able to get support for housing and hopefully move to a bigger house with more bedrooms. So we're beginning to see a really direct impact of that type of approach. It's something different, but it's combining the welfare advice and information and help alongside the holistic whole family support that we're able to provide. And we think it's going to be a really useful way in which we can look at how we can support families in different parts of the country.
Thanks very much. Natalie, do you have anything further at this point?
No, not at this point. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Can we move on to questions from Emma Roddick? And just to remind everybody that broadcasting will operate your microphone, so you don't have to worry about that yourselves. And if we could go to Emma, please.
Thank you, convener. I wanted to ask Gordon specifically about the issue of direct deductions as well as rent being paid direct to landlords. The role of social security is not just to increase income to some magic number where everything's fine. It also plays a part in addressing often extreme cash flow issues, and a common one being that rent can total over half your income, and adding repayments to that, it could be over 70%. Are there concerns about social security being used to underwrite often unfairly high rents, which could even be increased as a reaction to the existence of those measures without actually looking at the fact that the rent is higher than it should be and higher than it's possible to pay?
Yes. I mean, there's a couple of things when we talk about rent rises just now. One of them is the social sector rent rises are baked into the Scottish Government's model of funding new housing. So there's an expectation that more and more of the share of the cost of new development comes from existing rents. So we've seen that pushing up rents. So that's a Scottish choice that has been made in Scotland, that we could take a view to put more on as general taxpayers rather than existing social tenants. So suppressing the, you know, or broadening the base for which we fund new investment in housing is one area that we could have an impact. But the biggest issue really is that, you know, we have a scarce commodity of homes. We're seeing the private rented sector increasingly the preferred choice of decision makers for low income households to go into, and rents are set at the local area market level. So the housing tribunal, when they're asked to consider whether a rent rise is too high, aren't looking at whether that landlord has a mortgage of 90% or no mortgage at all. They're looking at what the next door property is also charging. So we have a skewed way of working out what is a fair rent. And I think we should have a conversation not about high rents, low rents, but about fair rents, fair to the landlord and fair to the tenant. The issue then becomes the ability to take money out immediately through some of these debt recoveries. It does just mean that we're placing people in a spiral that they can't get themselves out of. And when you add the fuel poverty costs on top of that, and the correlation between people in low-income households and the higher cost fuel charges that come with prepayment meters and other things, mean that we're not making it easier. You know, the harder your life, the harder we make it. And we are now getting to a place where there's no amount of advice and information can change the fundamentals of people have too little coming in and too much going out. And that's often even where there is no pre-existing debt. That is just the cost. You know, we talk about the cost of living. That's what we mean. So there is, I think there's sometimes a risk that we look at one lever and try and pull on that without taking a look at the whole picture. But there is more we could do to say that it's a whole society responsibility to ensure that low-income households have access to genuinely affordable and genuinely secure housing, and that when people do fall into hard times, we're not taking money out of their accounts in such a way that we're condemning them to a cycle of debt, which only ends up back at the homelessness service further down the line, and local authorities having to pick up that bill. There doesn't seem to be an incentive between local authority, or certainly between different agencies, to think about the whole cost to the public sector. It's just a, you know, one team's job is to recover arrears, one team's job is to recover council tax, and one team's job is to sustain tenancies. Making people work together, involving third sector partners in that, does make a difference. And you've heard today of much evidence from different organisations as to where it works. It works really well.
Emma, do you have anything further?
That's me. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much for that, Emma. I'm going to take two final questions before we do stop for a wee pause. I've got a question from Paul and then from Faisal Chowdhury.
Thanks, convener. Probably this one's for Gordon. Gordon, some of the evidence that you put through, or some of the evidence we've got through, is around about advice for public sector, but also against the private sector. I think there's figures to show the increase for public sector rent arrears, but not so much for the private sector. So I suppose one of the questions is around about, you know, can we get that evidence? Because obviously I think you've seen that increase. I think some anecdotal evidence behind that has shown that. How difficult is it to get to the private rented sector when it's kind of so diverse? And what can we do specifically around about that? Because I think noticed one of the things, the key cost for an eviction is around about £24,000. So, and I suppose the other question to yourself is, how can we be preemptive in terms of the advice we give, rather than, you know, when people arrive on the doorstep, or come, can we be more preemptive to try and get that advice out to them quicker before they get into trouble? So probably yourself, Gordon, and maybe open it up to Martin, just on that as well at some stage.
There's a couple of touch points where I think we could be gathering better data that we don't currently. So there's landlord registration. How are we using that as a compliance mechanism, or are we trying to actually understand, do we have a point of contact for the landlord and the letting agent? The two are not the same. Are local authorities able to properly identify what the level of rent is? There's also the security deposits schemes. So when a tenancy starts, the ability to, when you're required to place that deposit in there, there's an obvious opportunity to gather what the level of rent is. We would like to see in any upcoming housing bill a look at using those touch points to gather more data, annual information on what the rents are, annual information about who the responsible person is to get in touch. We also know from just before the pandemic, we did some research, just some analysis of the first tier tribunal system in the private rental sector, looking at the disparity between representation, and I think it was the numbers for cases where landlords had legal representation and found their favour was in the region of 98%. That went down to only 88% with the find in favour of the landlord when they didn't have representation. And equally, tenants only had representation I think 14%, 6% of the time, but when they did, the likelihood of them succeeding doubled. And what we have is that sort of disparity of arms, if you like, in the tribunal system. Now, there's lots of reasons for that. It might be that cases that that tenants choose to defend, or cases where they're more contested. It's not a straightforward rent arrears, or somewhere where there's maybe been an abandonment of the property. But we do have an incredibly diverse private rented sector. Is it reasonable to expect a small local authority licensing team to try and keep in touch with that whole sector? There is a consultation just now on how to improve the fair renting system. And I think it's an opportunity to explore what's the difference between a landlord regulator and an ombudsman or someone who can act on behalf of tenants, so that it's on a case-by-case basis. Because we have to accept this is the housing system that we have. We are only offering low-income households private rented sector. We need to therefore acknowledge that it's costing the public sector money when those tenancies fail. Let's use those touch points, gather the data, make the new powers discretionary so that courts can make judgments based on the case, not on arbitrary thresholds, and then use the upcoming legislative opportunities to strengthen the protections for tenants.
Gordon, thanks for that. Martin, probably just on yourself, just on the preemptive part, and there's always going to be the budgetary pressures and resource pressures in terms of having to deal with people who arrive at the door, if you like, in terms of saying, I need help. And again, this is maybe cost effectiveness. Can we do more at the start before people get into that situation? You mentioned before around about family support and family advice, which I think is incredibly important. I don't know if you want to just expand a little bit more on that, or any more thoughts on that, because again, I suppose it's almost investing to further down the line, if you like, to make sure people, not as many people, get to the situation that they arrive in.
Well, that's exactly right. And we would always advocate for as early intervention and prevention, preventative approaches as possible to prevent people getting into financial difficulty. I think for in our experience, because of the nature of the support that we provide, either through our Urgent Assistance Fund, which in itself, by definition, is a crisis fund, or through some of the support, the kind of pilot work I was describing in Tayside, which again is where families have been identified that they're in real, the families who are referred are in real deep kind of financial difficulty, and they require that additional kind of combination of financial welfare advice and support alongside the kind of family support that helps with the other challenges families are experiencing. Holistically. The very nature of both those approaches is that they're responding to people when they're at a point of crisis. I think it's clear that as I've already mentioned, as we're going through this particular period of real financial uncertainty and insecurity and anxiety for people, and all that means is that people who are already in financial crisis are in even worse and deeper poverty for many of the families that we work with, is the earlier we can do anything, the better. And that includes help and support around advice, welfare advice. That includes help and support around things, very simple things like budgeting and money management. Although on that point, I probably would say, because I think it's quite often a kind of a trope that's rolled out quite often, is that often it's perceived that people who are in the lowest incomes or people who are living in poverty are not very good at managing money. And I would counter that to say that the families that we work with are actually probably some of the most prudent money managers that you'll ever come across. They know where every penny goes and they can count for every part of their income. The problem is that the income simply isn't enough to cover the costs, and that's increasingly becoming the reality. But yeah, prevention, early intervention, in whatever way we can provide it is always something we would call for and advocate, and that's just true around welfare advice and money support services as it is with anything else.
Thanks very much for that. And Faisal, just before we stop for a wee break, it's your turn.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I have a small question. We know that sheriffs are making up for lost time because of the pandemic. When is the tidal wave of evictions going to hit? And do we have any estimate how many families are going to be affected by that?
Gordon
or Martin, if you want to come in.
I'll defer to Gordon if that's okay, because that's not necessarily my area of expertise.
I don't have a number that I can say that, you know, on this day, but we are seeing the courts banking up. What we are seeing is some people choosing now to engage, including the landlords. You know, whilst the effective, not actual, but effective eviction ban was in place, We just haven't seen that. We didn't see the growth in homelessness that we may have anticipated otherwise. We are now seeing people ending up in court. We're seeing more cases being fought, and we're seeing a steady rise in eviction again. The reason we won't see it as a tidal wave in one go is that there is simply a capacity limit on courts. There's only so many courts and so many court times. So we're seeing more complex cases take a little bit longer. We're seeing some people just choosing to abandon tenancies or finding other ways out of the situation. But we're going to see just a higher number of regular cases than the pre-pandemic situation. So it won't be in one quarter we'll see a short sustained spike, but we're going to see a higher number over a consistent period of time.
Did you want to come in on that, Betty? You don't need to touch your mic.
the last I heard, the cases that were going up, there was 38, actually, for going up, because we do have meetings with the council where we're saying this, but I believe it has risen through the roof since the last time we had our meeting. I don't know about evictions. I don't think they help anybody, because they've got to be rehoused anyway. I think early intervention has just not been there on the part of the council. They do send out letters, as I say, but people don't know how to read these letters, so they can't read them. I get a lot of people coming to me with their letters and asking me to read them for them. They think the council owes their money because they can read numbers. They can tell numbers, but they can't read the letter. And I've got to tell them, no, you owe the council money, you know, and it's difficult. And if somebody says universal credit, getting it in their hand, they thought their rents and that, were, a lot of people thought their rents and that had been taken off that. So it landed them in debt immediately. So the arrears in Edinburgh, I know, are sky high now, and we have to do something to avoid it, because the stories are horrendous that I'm hearing from people that just can't manage it. How do they pay rent? How do they feed their kids? I've got grown men that are actually working, not on benefits, that are coming and sitting crying because they have to go to food banks. They feel degraded because they have to go to food banks because they're not earning enough money to actually keep their families.
I think that's an important point as well, that we always need to remember, is the fact that people in work. Yes. Are some of the are people that are experiencing severe hardship at the moment, and more people that are in work are going to perhaps find themselves in that position going down the line. Faisal, did you have something?
Yeah, for Gordon again. How much does it cost local authorities to evict someone and put them into the homelessness system?
So research we did last year showed that for a single male who's got what we call low support needs, so not someone who is in need of in-depth support for any multiple complex challenges they have, and are likely to be in temporary accommodation for a long time because there's not the move-on accommodation necessarily available, you're looking at a conservative estimate of about £24,000 per eviction. So it is a significant cost. Those are both direct and indirect costs. And it shows to us that there's not a business case, it's certainly not a moral case, but there's not a business case for using eviction and the threat of eviction as a rent arrears collection tool. It doesn't work, it costs you more money. So let's invest in the early intervention services, the advice, the representation that we know works, so we can join the evidence and improvement service and others about how it works. But we actually have to do it. We have to see this also in the context of local authorities are under enormous financial pressure, and many are seeking to revert solely to their statutory duties. These are types of services that make sense because we know they work, but there's not a duty placed on them to do all of them. I'm not advocating that we place more and more duties, especially duties that aren't really funded from central government. But I think it's important to understand the context within which some of these failures are occurring.
That gives us a perfect spot to stop and take a break. So we'll come back about 16 minutes past, so 5 minutes if that's okay for everybody. And if you do need to dip away, because I know that we've asked our witnesses to be here for 2 hours, just please let the clerks know if you are not able to stay for the full of the next session. So we'll take a wee break at the moment and I suspend the meeting. Thank you. Welcome back. Thanks everybody for making sure you were back on time, and thanks for those online for being back at your keyboards. I'm going to start again on our theme three, which was round about council tax arrears, but we've already touched on that a lot, so members' questions have maybe kind of changed or they don't need to ask them. But I'm going to bring in my colleague Miles Briggs for a question on this.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you very much for joining us today. I know we've covered a lot on council tax, but I wanted to ask a couple of questions. And I'll start specifically with regards to what the committee's heard with regards to legislation in England. And the Local Government Act of 1992 gives local authorities in England the discretion to accept reduced payments or write off debt as well. Is that something we've seen applied in any way in Scotland? And how could that be replicated to develop a new model to really address those two issues? I'll maybe bring in Paul first, and then Karen, that's maybe something you want to...
The short answer is yes, but probably not to a significant extent. The fair collection policy I referred to, and I think Fife is a good example of that one, is where obviously we look at such as an individual, but we deal with the ongoing liability, and then we look to whether mitigation of the historical debt would allow that ongoing payment to be better sustained. It needs to be done in recognition that this is the public's money, it's council taxpayers' money, so it can't be done liberally. It is tested very thoroughly throughout a few stages. So the answer is yes, it is done in Scotland, but it needs to be basically bespoke to that circumstance. And obviously we cannot incentivise people to accrue arrears with the intention of hoping to get those relieved at a future date. So we need to be very careful. And we also need to understand why that person didn't go through the bankruptcy process. Is council tax only debt they owe, and is it not material in terms of the bankruptcy requirements? So we need to understand all those things. But yeah, as applied, generally Falkirk, we do write off debt of that nature, but it is very rarely reduced from whether we've got ongoing liability, because we believe that, generally speaking, ongoing liability means that debt is collectible if they're not bankrupt.
Okay, thank you.
I'll cover it.
Turning that argument on its head, in terms of different models, Betty, you had outlined letters, which currently seem to be the main way people are then contacted around this debt and then how that's pursued. To what extent can we shift towards a preventative model so that that letter is triggering actually a process, for example, like a financial health check? Because we'll know that council tax is often the last debt, and one people want to start, feel they can start with not paying instead of rent and things. So where could that be a different model? And does anyone have any examples of where different countries are doing things differently like that? And literacy being one of the key parts of that. Betty, I'll maybe bring you in as
well. I think if this is picked up soon enough in the local housing offices, visiting that person as soon as their arrears start to become into arrears. As you say, council tax is the last thing a person will pay if they're struggling with money. Definitely. I've seen that 18 times. They don't see the need for them to pay council tax. They don't think they can be evicted for council tax. But definitely, I think you need more people out on the ground to visit these people. And they do come and visit them, but I'm getting stories that they're quite aggressive with the people. I've asked for housing officers to be retrained and how to deal with people that do have, because there's so much mental health out there that people, once they're talked down to, they'll not go back to the council and talk to them. So they have to learn how to talk to these people in a manner that helps them to understand they are in arrears and how to pay that, and not to say to them, as I've been saying, you need to pay that off right away. No, work out a plan with them and how to address that, and it does help.
Mm-hmm. One council, I don't want to name them because they're only considering this, are looking at incentivising people to seek advice. So they're going to make a payment to them to help them reduce their debt if they seek advice services. But it's at the early development stages, and it is quite a radical approach, so it's under consideration.
Thanks. That's maybe something you could provide further information for us to investigate and look at. Separately. Martin, you had mentioned evidence around what you'd like to see in a public debt bill. Is there kind of more in that we as a committee should consider looking at? And with regard to the problems we've discussed this morning, what would you see? That is that almost a version of what is the Local Government Finance Act then?
So I think the intention behind that would be to bring Scotland in line with what progress has already been made across other parts of the UK in terms of regulation and what private lenders and credit agencies need to do in terms of the response they take when they're pursuing or looking to recover debt. I think within that there's particular considerations that any bill or any legislation or strategy around it would need to consider. One of the things that we are aware of in terms of families that we support who have multiple public debts is often those multiple debts are debts to the same local authority but different departments within the local authority. And it's often the case that those departments aren't necessarily speaking to each other and recognising and being able to understand and map out where there are families who might well be struggling, and that's evident through the fact that they owe money to different parts of the councils. So making sure that councils are speaking to each other, internally speaking to each other, and that whatever processes are being employed around recovery for multiple debts, including council tax, are done in a way that are, first of all, responsive and acknowledge the family's circumstances and are compassionate, I suppose, because what we know is, for so many families who are struggling financially, usually or often, families are also experiencing a range of other challenges and issues in their lives, and being sensitive and compassionate around that and making sure that the response, in the first instance, to try and understand what family circumstances are and what can be put in place is obviously much preferable to a letter automatically generated in relation to council tax arrears that in 4 weeks' time can be, can result in that debt being passed to sheriff's officers or external debt agencies or what have you. So just thinking differently, thinking more compassionately, thinking about how we can also use better the resource that might at the minute be channeled into debt recovery, but is there a way in which we can think differently and how we do that in a more holistic way that's more responsive to families' actual circumstances?
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And I think that also reminds me of the fact that councils hold a lot of data and information, and there's a need as well for them to passport where a family's eligible to receive another payment, whether that's school meals or whether there's other things that we need to make sure that councils do that as well, because we are the holders of that data. Pam Duncan-Gladsey, you want to come in?
Thank you, Convener. On the point about data collection, some of the evidence that we have suggests that the data collection on council tax arrears and other public debt arrears could improve. So I wonder if someone could mention that. It just occurred to me that it would be good to know more about that. And then I had a specific question for Paul. This one's probably it's about public debt, but it's not something that's been mentioned yet. And it's around social care charging. And I wondered if you could comment on the sort of debt that you're seeing through that revenue stream.
Yes, obviously, I don't know the actual role locally on the setting of the local social care charges, but certainly I'm aware from we take a light touch, I suppose, to recovering that debt for specific reasons, as guided by the IGIB within the local setting. But we have significant debt in that area because we have a policy of charging a very low charge across a large caseload rather than a large charge to a smaller cohort. And what that means is that we have 3,000 or 4,000 people who pay a monthly fee of some sort for their care. That's fairly small, everything, the maximum £100 a month, give or take. But that does mean that they've got a lot of debtors. And people, because we don't effectively withdraw that service, people don't pay that one. And we have never yet passed any of those debt to our sheriff officer. So it's one of the things that in Falkirk that we have a difficulty with. But what's the correct approach? We try and support those people individually, address those debts to understand what the cause of that non-payment is, but as yet we have not taken any real diligence against those debtors because we understand that their needs for that care and support are greater than the need to recover that money.
So sorry, thank you for that. I missed the numbers. Did you say there the number of people who are in debt for that reason and the amount, or were you talking about the number of people you're charging? No.
So, sorry, we charge 3,000 to 4,000. The number who have multiple invoices outstanding probably amounts to about 300 or 400 individuals. so circa 10% of those who were charged for. And those range from being a few months to being 6 or 7 years worth of partial debts since the charging policy came into place. So it is quite significant for some, but most people only pay what we call the MEX charges for their device at home for safety. But obviously that's a small sort of charge, but around about 10% have a material debt for social care charges in Falkirk.
Thank you.
Karen, on you go, Dentsey.
It was just to say in the question to data, we collect data for the local government benchmarking framework, and one of the measures is the percentage of income due from council tax received by the end of the year. So we can give you a top level figure of how much we've got. We know how much we haven't got or hasn't been collected, but breaking it down, I'm not sure the sort of granularity of that data, but I can check that out and see if we've got that for you.
Thank you.
That would be very helpful. Thanks very much. We're going to move on to our fourth theme, which is around about the role of social security system in debt. And I'm going to bring in my colleague Emma Roddick, who is online. Emma.
Thank you, convener. This question is for Kirsty. One thing that I find particularly difficult in thinking about the wait for, like, say, universal credit is that debt gets bigger very fast. Those 5-6 weeks can cause as much to be added to the debt as the person is about to get in social security. What should the Scottish Government be doing about this, and what should it be asking the UK Government to do?
And if we can go to Kirsty.
Thank you very much for that question. You're absolutely right. The system of the 5-week wait does cause a huge amount of debt for people. We know that in November 2021, 47% of universal credit claimants in Scotland had a deduction, and of them, 45% of those claimants, it was due to having to pay back the advance that they'd received during the 5-week wait. It's really quite a tricky thing. I think ideally we would like to see the advance become non-repayable. That would be an issue for the Westminster government, because we know that universal credit is a basic amount of money to live on, and right from the off, that amount of money is being reduced month on month for people to live on. So there's an issue there. In terms of what the Scottish government could do, we would like to see further investment in the Scottish Welfare Fund to help people during that period, and strengthen the guidance about being able to make payments to people who are struggling during that period. Part of the complexity about the response to the 5-week wait is that it's difficult to anticipate how much universal credit somebody's going to receive, and that's why it's difficult to make a specific call on the Scottish Government about the response, other than something like Scottish Welfare Fund. But in terms of the UK government, we'd be saying it should be a non-repayable grant.
Thanks very much for that. Emma, do you have anything further on that point?
No, that was good. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much. And if we can move back to Pam for questions in this theme, and then Miles after that. Pam?
Thank you, convener. I nearly wasn't ready there for, so I was taking some notes. Thank you very much for that. On the social security theme, it's kind of, I guess, an extension of Emma's question. We've taken some evidence in this committee in writing from Close the Gap and in other committees that I sit on, from them as well in person, talking about the specific experience of women who are experiencing significant debt. For all the reasons that I know many of us will understand. And in particular, they've highlighted the significant debt that's experienced by disabled women, black minority ethnic women, and particularly lone parent families. So I wondered if perhaps CPAG and Aberlour could comment on what we could do in Scotland with the powers that we have here to try and target resources to those groups.
Yeah, I'll come in there, Pam, if that's okay. So, absolutely, you're right. Women's poverty and child poverty are intrinsically linked. I mean, there's no getting away from that. And we see the evidence of that, particularly through our Urgent Assistance Fund. The vast majority of applications that come through our Urgent Assistance Fund are from single-parent families, the vast majority of whom are women. Even then, with our two-parent households, it's most often the mum who's making applications to our fund. We also see a disproportionate increase in the number of black minority ethnic and families with no recourse to public funds also, who have been making applications through our Urgent Assistance Fund over the period of the pandemic. Mm. The families with no recourse to public funds specifically is not a surprise, given that there's very little other avenue for them to seek financial support. We've given evidence to the Social Security Committee previously in the last session about the role of the Scottish Welfare Fund and some of the challenges that we've encountered. During the pandemic, we were seeing somewhere in the region of about 10% of applications to our fund were from families who were who had unsuccessfully applied for one reason or another, or had not been able to access support through the Scottish Welfare Fund. So we know there's still existing challenges and things that the Scottish Government, we have called on the Scottish Government, along with others who are sitting on this panel, to do more. One of the things we would call on the Scottish Government to do right now around the Scottish Welfare Fund is to expedite the review into the role and the management of the Scottish Welfare Fund and delivery of the Scottish Welfare Fund. We actually know what lots of the issues and challenges are, and we have, along with others, have highlighted that from our own evidence. And so we think there's the wait or the time that it has taken thus far and is likely to take for that review to take place before we can start implementing some of the improvements and challenges. We don't think that should be taking as long as it is. In terms of families with no recourse to public funds specifically, I think there's more that we can do. I think the Scottish Government, and we've made calls on the Scottish Government to do more and to think better and to think differently about the things that we could, the actions that they could take working alongside local authorities, using local government powers that exist as opportunities for delivery mechanisms whereby we can support families with crisis payments. There's Section 20 and Section 22 payments, I think, under local government legislation would allow that. Despite the prohibitions that are put on other public funds from UK government and from the Home Office. So there is a lot more that we can do, and alongside that, offering a much more coherent and consistent approach to how we practically support families with no recourse to public funds as well. And certainly, I think there's much more that we can do. And we are doing what we can. Other organisations like Aberlour and Children's Charities are similarly supporting those families, particularly who are the most vulnerable and have the least access to help and support. But we would reiterate the calls that we've made before and the calls of others that are on this panel to say that the Scottish Welfare Fund can certainly be improved. It can be done much quicker than it is. We know what the challenges are, and the challenges can be should be addressed right now, and families with no recourse to public funds, there's much more we can also do, as I've kind of indicated.
Thank you.
Kirsty, did you want to come in on that point as well?
Yes, thank you. I would agree with everything that Martin has just said. In addition, we would make the point that at the moment there is, of the benefit system, there are lots of different eligibility criteria for different benefits, including the family benefits. And one of the things that would simplify things greatly would be to make some of the eligibility criteria the same. So, for example, free school meals, remove the for either accelerate universal school meals or at the very least remove the income thresholds. Because at the moment it's not available to anybody in receipt of universal credit. It's available to people who are in receipt of universal credit and have income below a certain level. And because there's different criteria for all of these different benefits, it makes it very difficult to automate the system of having to automate all of these payments, and that you could apply for one payment and then you would automatically become entitled to lots of different payments. So by improving the eligibility criteria, that would make that much easier. I think the Social Security is not the only lever, so we need to look at things like improving childcare, reducing costs for families through things like cost of the school day. All of these different things can be done to contribute to families receiving money. And coming back to the point that was made earlier about advice and assistance, that if somebody is in debt, this should be seen as an opportunity to pick up on all of the issues that a family may be facing, and not just to deal with the debt that's being presented with at that point in time.
Thanks very much for that, Kirsty. And with regards to the no recourse to public funds, I think it probably would benefit the committee if we had an update on the anti-destitution strategy that was being worked on between COSLA and others. And can I now move on to questions from Miles, please?
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask with regards to Social Security Scotland, where you think they could also play a role in this. We've been looking at some of the prevention of homelessness duties, for example, and that preventative model being put in. Now, with regards to debt, when people are in contact with organisations like Social Security Scotland, where do you think they could also help at least point towards some of the advice services which might be available, but a different model and that early intervention approach potentially to help people? I don't know if anyone wants to come in on that.
So I'll pick on somebody. I don't know. I've got Paul has an R in the chat, but it was for the last question. But I'll put the onus on Paul at the moment.
Yeah, I think that most local authorities, Social Security Scotland, are present within our advice support hubs and delivering the face-to-face services from there. And I think that we actually have about half a dozen staff based within one of those offices. I think that what we want to do is a warm handover. So if Social Security Scotland engages with a client that they know is in need of support, then I think they need to have appropriate contacts with each local authority and about area managers that we deal with to allow that warm handover to happen. So it's not just a referral, it's not just a point to here's where you get help, it's actually that introduction, that handover and reach that we can take over from there and obviously just keep the both parties informed. It's not really worked as well during the pandemic because obviously the face-to-face presentations have been limited, but I think that going forward, I'm hopeful that will be a fruit for our most vulnerable clients because obviously those that currently engage with Social Security Scotland and will do this year through adult disability payment are amongst our most vulnerable households. And it's critical that we offer them that extra level of support. So I'm hopeful that will be a fruit, not just in Falkirk, but across the nation. That's what's been attempted across the whole of Scotland, is that sort of warm handover being crucial to the customer journey.
Thanks. And, you know, we've heard quite a lot this morning with regards to different departments within the same council, people having different debts with them and them not communicating. Is that purely just because you've got different teams? And why, in this day and age, do systems not manage to communicate in the same organisation to you know, red flag debts and therefore create, you would hope, some sort of manageable plan for individuals and at least then potentially have that trigger process to refer to support either within that organisation or towards? And is that something any council is, you know, to point towards councils specifically around council tax and rent are developing models around?
I think that's back to you, Paul.
Yes. Yep. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. I would agree entirely that if we go back to 1996 when councils were formed, there were some councils that kept their rent separate. Those have become less and less frequent. Some of them have housing stocks, others have sort of merged it. And those that are keeping it discreet have adopted corporate debt policies with a system that combines those debts. So I think that I don't recognise that because in Falkirk we have always had both debts collected together. So we have never had that segregation. So my staff have always dealt with council tax and rents. And I think that bears fruit with individual customers. And I think the movement certainly over the last 25 years has been towards that being more universal. It's maybe not quite there yet, but I recognise very few authorities that don't combine the knowledge of the tenant with the rent debt and the knowledge of the taxpayer for the council tax debt. But that is the exception rather than the rule in Scotland, as far as I'm concerned.
Can I bring Betty in on that? And then I've got Kirsty online who wants to come in as well.
I totally agree with you. Communication is absolutely horrendous at the moment between the different sections in the council. I just had a case yesterday where communication with two different sections and it's landed the person in £1,500 rent arrears. So no, not on her behalf, through the council's behalf. And she's in a terrible state over it. But when we have what we call business meetings with the council, and what was started asking for all the different sections to come into that business meeting, so we do have them in the same room and they do communicate with each other, because that has been a huge, huge difficulty, is getting them to talk to each other over, especially this last few years, because they've been at home. Mm-hmm. People have been working from home and they just did not communicate with each other whatsoever. So it's bringing them back to talking to each other again. It's a huge job, believe me.
Thank you. And Kirsty?
It was really just coming back to the point that was being made about Social Security Scotland and the support that they can provide. We're now in a position where people can claim benefits from DWP, Social Security Scotland, local authorities, HMRC. And I think not only is it important that staff are able to do the warm handovers for people, but also that they are equipped with enough knowledge to know where to make those warm handovers to, with the benefit system being so interlinked now. So for things like the disability benefits that will be available in Scotland may lead to additional amounts in benefits being delivered by DWP, and things like universal credit then lead to benefits being payable from Social Security Scotland. It's really important that the staff have enough knowledge to be able to make those links with the other benefits that people may be entitled to. And I think in terms of the onus needs to be less on the claimant to know what to claim and who to claim it from, and much more on the benefit system to help make those links for them.
Thanks very much. Do you have a supplemental to that, Pam?
I do, if you do.
Yeah, I'm done. Thanks.
Thank you. It's just occurred to me, and thanks, convener, for allowing me to sneak a wee supplementary in here. It's just occurred to me that what it feels like has been described as people being project managers in their own life. So your point, Betty, about having to bring in a business meeting to get this sorted. Is there anyone in either a local authority or a third sector organisation that you think could kind of provide that role so that it's... I get the warm handover thing, and I think that we absolutely have to do that and take the point that Kirsty's made about all the different agencies. But is there anyone within statutory services that you think could be providing that coordinating role that would help?
I think there is, and I think we've actually spotted somebody within the council that it is a huge role, mm-hmm. To get people, you know, all the different sectors together, who we're actually working with now, and the person has made a huge difference in talking to them, and it's good that we can actually just have a private meeting, just no agenda, just face to face as well, so that we can make sure we're talking for the same hymn book and before we have these meetings. Definitely. Yep.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. And I think there is evidence of good practice across the country where we have some housing officers that become neighbourhood coaches, and it's a coaching model and it's a different way of operating. And also universal credit teams being set up that are actually proactively going out into communities, or, as Karen said before, you do have financial inclusion officers that are based within school clusters in some areas, and that's making a massive difference. So I think, you know, there's a lot of good work been done, and it's how we passport that across the country and how this committee could play a role in that. And finally, on this section, before we move on to a couple of questions about school meal debts, I've got Paul.
Yeah, thanks, convener. And you kind of just touched on the point that I was going to refer to. I think previous stakeholders have talked around about solutions with people in debt. It isn't just about reforming the debt processes and how we deal with that, it's how we increase incomes via the social security system. And I think, just seeing if anybody wants to expand on the point, I think the committee just touched on it about universal credit teams. Is there more that can be done in that regard? And I think Kirsty kind of just touched on another point as well. Kirsty, you mentioned around about simplification of the process in terms of criteria, but also we talked about the complications within local authorities around about who deals with what. So can more be done in that regard? And it was interesting this morning that the Audit Scotland had a report out talking about the rollout of the benefits system so far in Scotland, saying it's successful, but challenges remain. We've got 20% devolved benefits at the moment. By 2025, it's going to be 70%. Is there any lessons we can learn between now and 2025 around about how we roll out these other benefits to make them as effective as possible? Kirsty, I'll probably come to yourself first of all, just on the point you mentioned about criteria and I suppose, equity to the access to the system, and I'll maybe open it up after that.
So I think, as I said earlier, there are different eligibility criteria for different benefits, but that includes benefits that can be paid to low-income families. Even within those benefits, there are different criteria, and that makes it very difficult for people to know what they might be entitled to. But it also makes it very difficult to passport from one benefit to another automatically. It can be done for the people on the lowest incomes, but unless there's a parity between all those low-income benefits that are available to families, it's going to make eligibility automation very difficult. And until you have that kind of automation, you're always going to have lower than 100% take-up. So anything that can be done to improve take-up will improve families' incomes. And I think if, in terms of that kind of improving the or aligning the eligibility criteria, it'll take pressure off administration of the different parts as well. So that will simplify things at the back end too. So I think that's probably one of the key things that we're hoping to see in future that would make a big difference to families.
Yeah, thanks, Kirsty.
And over to Paul.
I really didn't sort of my request for the previous question. My apologies, it's just timing.
That's all right, don't worry about that. Paul, did you have anything further?
No, I mean, I don't know if anybody wants to come in that regard, because again, one is, I think, is the equity, but two is, I suppose, is making people aware. And again, that maybe comes back to the point, I know, Martin, you talked about before about trying to get that advice out there and being preemptive and same with points about it. I mean, I don't know if anybody wants to add anything to that, because I think there is an element of, yes, we need to increase the benefits that are there, but also there's also that accessibility, and do we need to do more in that regard?
OK, so we've got Betty, and then I don't know, Martin, if you wanted to say something.
My main concern is a lot of people don't know about these extra benefits. They're never advertised, they're never put onto the social... I mean, a lot of people are not on social media, but the council itself does have their own newspaper, the Courier, which is sent out to every tenant. It could be advertised in that. People don't know about these other benefits and they're never told about them, and I'd be surprised if housing officers knew about them. I'd be really surprised. So it's maybe about educating within the system itself to let them know that there is other benefits there.
Thanks, Betty.
And Martin, did you want to come in?
Yeah, maybe just to preempt what I was maybe going to say in the next section, but Kirsty's already touched on this, so I'll maybe just echo that, what she has said. One really straightforward and simple way the Scottish Government could certainly help and support families who are on low incomes, low-income working families who are not currently eligible for free school meals, would be to increase the thresholds, income thresholds for free school meals as they are. That wouldn't require an increase in other benefits necessarily, but it would help catch lots of families who are otherwise struggling. And a lot of the work that we've been doing around school meal debt has highlighted the real struggles for families who are above that threshold currently, but are on low incomes and struggling to feed their children. And so by increasing the thresholds, which haven't, by the way, been increased in line with inflation under successive UK governments since 2010, would be to increase those thresholds, and also potentially the same could be done around council tax thresholds as well. And in doing so, you would provide welcome breathing space and much more reassurance for many families who are otherwise struggling, who are in many of the circumstances we've talked about this morning, who are struggling with public authority debts, but at the same time, so you would alleviate that, and you would also give them the reassurance that they would be entitled to something that would be really, really helpful, particularly at this current point of the cost of living catastrophe, as I've mentioned a couple of times before.
Okay, so that segues us nicely onto questions around about school meal debts. And to kick us off, we'll take a question from Faisal Chowdhury, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I just wanted to know that because of the cost of living is raising every day, do you have an estimate how many families are in danger of falling into school meal debts?
Is that for me?
Yeah.
So our analysis and the work that we've done in our research so far indicates that at the moment there's around 25,000 children around Scotland whose families are currently in some level of school meal debt. What is probably important to understand is when you dig down into that data, because of the nature which we've kind of covered in our evidence submission previously, I can maybe expand on a little bit here. Because of the nature of the difficulty, really, I suppose, of being able to accrue school meal debt for secondary school pupils, that data actually really only includes those children in primary schools who are not currently or have not until recently been eligible for free school meals. So we're talking about a relatively small cohort of children. A very narrow cohort, I should say, of children and their families who, on the information that we have, we can see are experiencing debt in relation to school meals that they've accumulated. And for the vast majority of those children, it is primary schools. What we're really concerned about, and what we think the research is pointing to, and actually we've got some really powerful anecdotal evidence around this as well, is that there's a real issue around hidden school hunger, particularly for children in secondary school, where because of the automated cashless payment systems that are in place, which most authorities, most schools, high schools now operate, which are the mechanism by which children and their parents pay for and order their school meals, when those accounts are at zero, a lot of authorities don't offer the capacity to be able to access a meal or to be able to build up or accrue any level of debt. So what we know is, and what we're beginning to see, is that the likelihood is there's plenty of children, a significant number of children that we're not even aware of, what the scale of that might be, who are simply going without. With explicit council policies in some authorities where the school meal debt policy is that if a child in secondary school doesn't have any credit on their account, they can't get access to a meal. So that's quite shocking and very, very concerning for us. To kind of illustrate that point, we have done some level of engagement and spoken to some children, young people that we work with at Aberlour, and we explored this with some of them. And I'm just going to give you a couple of insights here from some of the young people we've spoken to on this specific issue. So one of them had, one young person told us that, I know a good few people who don't actually get lunch because they feel like they're using the money their parents could be using for something better. They feel responsible. So they don't buy lunch so they can give the money back to their parents. In my friendship group, I'd say about half of them can't eat food when we go out. So you see people buying food for their friends. They come to lunch with me even though they've got no money for anything. We go to Greg's because I've got £3 to spend. I'll get two yum-yums and a sausage roll and I'll give them the yum-yums because I know otherwise they're not going to have anything to eat. So this is the experience of children and young people that we have spoken to. We know this is a real, real concern. And so even the data that we have, we know is very limited and only gives us a very small snapshot of what we think is a much, much bigger concerning issue of the likelihood of children across Scotland, particularly in high school, going hungry.
Do you know any percentage of the students bringing debt from primary school to the high schools?
So we don't have a percentage, but what I can tell you is that we've broken down the number of local authorities who have a policy, who apply a policy whereby that debt will transfer. And I think somewhere in the region of about... So 11 local authorities said they would write the debt off at the point at which a child transfers from primary school into secondary school or at the point at which a child moves on from school entirely. So there's 11 out of 32 local authorities. I think there was a couple of local authorities that didn't respond to our Freedom of Information requests. But that's less than half. So we can then say that the majority of schools operate a policy where that debt that's accrued in primary school will follow children as they move and their families as they move into high school. That debt then, in most circumstances, I think 17 local authorities indicated that where that debt is not repaid within a period, it's then referred to their debt collection agencies internally. Sometimes it will even be referred to sheriff's officers. So there's a real concern around the practice, around the policies at an individual level at schools and across local authorities. And the most concerning thing is that it's highly inconsistent, depending on where you are in the country. It's a real postcode lottery about how schools, individual schools and local authorities will respond. The other really concerning bit is about families who might register late for free school meals during the school year for any number of reasons, and where some of those families who may become eligible or their eligibility may be confirmed at some point later on in the school year, not necessarily at the start of the school year, where they have maybe accrued a level of school meal debt up until the point their eligibility is confirmed, some councils will continue to pursue that debt. So they don't write it off. They will continue, even though the families are now eligible for free school meals. So there's a real concern for us around the practice and the policies that are in place. And so what we are calling for is we are really making a call on COSLA and on local authorities to work together where we so they can develop a much more consistent, a rights-based single policy to enable them to respond effectively and compassionately and in a supportive way to the families who find themselves accruing school meal debt. The thing that we are clear about is that families are not accruing debt or not paying for their children's meals because they don't want to. It's because they can't. And that's just a real symptom and indicative of the current circumstances in which we find ourselves. The important point to illustrate, I think, is that we're talking about families who are working, low-income working families. These are families who are above the thresholds for free school meals. So these are families who are currently struggling. And one of the really, perhaps surprising things we've been able to glean from the evidence we've been able to pull together is that this is a much greater issue in some of those local authorities where we would consider them to be wealthier or better off local authorities. So where they have historically below average child poverty rates and therefore they have fewer families eligible for free school meals, the current circumstances, the cost of living crisis, the issues that are going on just now are manifesting in many more families and proportionally in those local authorities struggling to be able to feed their children at school.
Martin, for that compelling evidence, and I think that you know the testimony from those young people is really important for us to hear. And young people always know when there's issues with poverty and debt and the family, and they carry that responsibility hugely on their shoulders. I have my colleague Emma Roddick, who wants to come in with a question round about data, and I know that Paul wants to come in, and then I can see Jeremy as well. So Emma, please.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, it's just for Martin. I know from the Aberlour report, which was really very helpful, that councils reported their data very differently. And thinking about your points around hidden hunger, is there greater data on who isn't eating at all or perhaps isn't eating enough? Is that available from any councils that you know of, or is it something that you would plan to look into?
Certainly something that we want to know more about and try and gather what information we can, but the reality is that information doesn't really exist. And I think that speaks to the way in which a lot of the automated cashless systems are implemented in high schools, the way in which, and they are applied inconsistently. It seems that sometimes at a local level, schools will have individually some level of management in terms of how those systems are set up. Sometimes it's done on a much more consistent basis across each authority. But nonetheless, In many cases, the systems are set up specifically to prevent people from accruing any debt. And so what we know is that when that account is at zero, and the only other option where for a child to be able to access a meal at school, in some of the policies that we've been provided with, that local authorities have in terms of how that is managed, it requires the young person, the child, to identify themselves, usually to a school member of staff at the school office, to go through a process where they would be given some kind of voucher or token that they then take into the dining hall in front of their peers and are visibly identified as somebody who doesn't have any money for a school meal. Now, while it's probably true that some pupils will go through that process, what we surmise and can make an educated guess around is that the vast majority of children in those circumstances are going to avoid that shame and that stigma and not want to have themselves identified as having no money or the inability to be able to pay for their school meal, and therefore it's likely that children are going hungry as a result. But we don't have because that data isn't captured, because it's not something that local authorities or schools individually are able to capture, because as far as they're concerned it will appear that there is no issue there because children are simply not identifying themselves. I suppose the other real concern for us is that in some cases, explicitly within individual school or local authority policies in responding to school meal debt or those children who don't have any money for a school meal and are not eligible for free school meals, the provision of a meal in some circumstances is identified as being discretionary. Now that to us is really, really, really alarming, because that effectively is telling us that decisions are being made at a local level in an individual and subjective way about whether or not a child will be able to access a meal by a member of personnel in an individual school. And that is a fundamental breach of children's rights. You know, children have a human right to be able to eat, to be able to access food. And if decisions are being made, for whatever reason, that a school or a school member of school personnel decides on any given day that a child, at their discretion, isn't entitled to access a meal despite the fact that they've got no money on their account, then that's a fundamental breach of children's rights. And a point at which we're looking towards the incorporation of UNCRC, I think it's quite a shocking thing to be able to illustrate in this day and age. So there's a real number of concerns that we're hoping to explore in much more detail, but the issue of data around hidden school hunger is problematic. That's why it's hidden.
Yep, Emma, you want to come back?
Yeah, thank you. I found it interesting there that you raised the stigma around free school meals. I remember when I was in primary school, free school meal tickets were a different colour to the ones purchased by other kids. Should there be guidance or maybe even rules on how schools deal with free meals and protect that characteristic or folks' identity?
I would absolutely say so. And in terms of having a single school meal policy that should be consistent, and that's something that I think we should look at a national level, but there's a responsibility for all local authorities and perhaps for COSLA to look at leading on that, so that there is a consistent response and approach across the country. In some cases, the automated systems are good and work well. And one of the things that is good about them is that for those who are eligible for free school meals, they access the automated system and choose their meals through the automated system in the same way as their peers who are paying for their meals or their parents are paying for their meals do. So there isn't any identifiable difference between a young person accessing the school meal through the automated payment system between those who access free school meals and those who don't. So in terms of addressing stigma, that's very, very positive. The problem is that for those young people who find themselves, who are not eligible for free school meals and who find themselves having to go through that very stigmatising, visible, convoluted process of saying to a member of school personnel, I don't have any money for a school meal, the process is very visible and very stigmatising, and it could be much, much better.
Thanks very much for that. And questions from Paul McClellan and then Jeremy.
Yeah, thanks. I'm conscious of the time. Martin, it's really just coming back to the point about the cost of recovery. I think you estimated that the debt was £1 million, but you know that'll probably be more. And I suppose it's coming back to what's the cost of recovery, but not also just the cost of resource and trying to get to that as well. I don't know if you have any other figures on that. It seems counterproductive to me. It's staring us right in the face. So I don't know if you have any other figures on that at all.
All I can say, we don't have any further figures on that. We just know that it's incomplete data because we haven't had a full suite of responses from all local authorities. But we can say it's a conservative figure. But even £1 million is not a lot of money in terms of Scottish Government budgets and national budgets. It could be, depending on which local authority you're talking about in the proportion, it could be a reasonable amount of money for a local authority or for a school. It's certainly the debt as it's accruing for families is a lot of money in their circumstances. Yeah. But at a national level, we would suggest that it would be a very simple and easy step to take for the Scottish Government to work alongside local authorities and work out the best way in which effectively they could just write that debt off. Okay. Because we don't see any reason why that debt should be burdened with that, and that it should certainly not transfer or move with families over potentially years as they move from primary school to secondary school, when we know that it's a symptom of the wider financial circumstances that everybody is experiencing right now. And the way in which that could then be prevented from happening again is simply, as I mentioned, by increasing the income thresholds for free school meals, and then you simply would be removing and reducing the likelihood of that happening again in the future.
Okay.
Thank you. And finally, Jeremy?
I think actually the last sentence there almost answered one of my questions, but just to seek clarification, I mean, I think from August, every child in primary school will get free school meals. Is that right?
Up to primary five get free school meals just now, and then
primary
six and seven
from August.
Or certainly later on in this parliament.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly.
Yeah. I think it's this August anyway, but we can move to check that. But looking at the secondary school issue, I suppose the question I had was, in your previous answer, you were talking about those who are in work who aren't entitled to free school meals at secondary school. And I suppose the question I had was, is how do you identify those individuals? Because unless you have free school meals across the board, so S1 to S6. And then the danger is you stigmatise people because those that have got money go out to get the lunch outside and those we don't have to then stay in the building, which could be a stigma. How do we identify those that need that help? And what way would you suggest schools go about doing that?
Well, I suppose, just reflecting on my previous answer around the increasing the income thresholds, for many of those families who are on low incomes but working, they will still be in receipt of some level of benefits at times. Kirsty has already spoken to the inconsistency and the different scales of benefits and where there's then the accessibility or that passports onto to other benefits, including things like free school meals. So if we were to simply raise the income thresholds, you would capture many, many more families, including the majority of families who are struggling but currently sitting above the thresholds. I don't know that would be in any way more stigmatising than the system as applied is just now, and the fact that we have the automated systems where people who are accessing children who are accessing free school meals are equally accessing it through the automated payment systems as their peers are who are paying for it, in a kind of very visible level. That's obviously kind of reducing any identifiable stigma. I probably don't have a very straightforward answer to that, other than to say that the first and most immediate step would certainly be to raise those thresholds, and then simply you're catching and capturing many, many more families and many more children who would benefit, and giving those families the reassurance that their children are coming to school and getting fed and giving them a bit more breathing space.
Thank you. Thank you, Gemina.
And I have Paul Ferguson online who would like to come in on that. Thanks.
Just a very quick point, accepting until there's a universal uplift in those thresholds, what Falkirk chose to do to sort of mitigate for this issue is that we apply a concession scheme that those who are households who are not below the thresholds but are on receipt of council tax reduction, i.e. we can identify that on low income, we will award that family a free school meal as well. And I think that comes at cost to Falkirk Council rather than Scottish Government. But I think that what that means is that as best we can, we identify people who we know are on low income and would benefit from that help. But the problem is that until there's a universal uplift in that threshold, then obviously it's going to be slightly piecemeal. What Falkirk does may not be done by our neighbours, but I think it's that we recognise there are people who are not eligible for free schools who actually do need that support on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah, thanks. And I think that was a great way to end that, because there is good practice across local authorities, but that's them choosing in a local way where they're using their budgets. And that's not something that can be applied across the board universally. So I think that's a good point to end on and for us to reflect on as a committee. So I would like to thank everybody this morning. That was a very marathon session, and I think it's evidence that we needed to hear. If you do have anything that you need to follow up with us, please just feel free to follow it up in writing for us as we're moving towards the conclusion of this inquiry. So thanks very much, and I hope you have a good rest of your day. And I'll briefly suspend this public session of the meeting so we can move into private session. Thank you.